There is a figure in antiquity who is both absolutely incredible and yet criminally underrated. His name is Melampus, or Melampus the Seer, and is one of mythology's most significant yet least remembered heroes. He was an Argonaut, Greece's first medic and prophet. He was said to have introduced the Greeks to Dionysian worship and to the practice of mixing their water with wine. He was part of a family of exceptional prestige, tracing his direct ancestry to Helene, the mythological founder of all Hellenic peoples, the titans Prometheus and Oceanus, and possibly even Zeus himself. And believe me when I say that Melampus more than lived up to the power and prestige of these ancestors. In fact, it's quite plausible to say that the reason Melampus gets so little attention is because the people of Homeric and classical Greece were already so familiar with his life and works. He plays a significant role in stories spanning multiple continents and generations, and few people in mythology travelled so widely, possessed so many powers, and accomplished so much as the great Melampus. He is mentioned in passing by several writers, with a lost epic called the Melampodia, attributed to Hesiod, written about him. But piecing together fragments of his life, his works, his accomplishments, could probably fill volumes. And so I'll do my very best here to provide as full an account of this legendary man's life as I can. He was born and raised in Pylos, a region of Messenia, long before the Trojan War. His father was Amythaion, son of King Cretheus of Iolcus, and Idomene, daughter of King Abas of Argos. He was raised in luxury with his brother Bias. Now, the earliest story of Melampus' life is while he was still a boy. There are a couple of variations of this story, but the general theme is that he came across two suffering snakes one day on the verge of death. He saved them, and while he slept that night, in return they cleansed his ears with their tongues, tasakoes tais glosais exekateiron, giving him the power to communicate with animals. Melampus awoke in fright, suddenly hearing the speech of a flock of birds flying overhead. From them he gained knowledge of things that would come to pass, the melonta, and so began his self-taught journey as a prophet and a seer. A little later in life, Melampus had been out hiking in the lands around Pylos along the banks of the river Alpheios. Here he was approached by none other than the god Apollo, who saw the young man's extraordinary potential and stayed with him a while. Apollo helped Melampus hone his prophetic skills, thereafter making him the most excellent of seers, Aristos Mantis. Melampus grew up into a man of great character and wisdom in one of Pylos' noble families. Now, the ruling king of Pylos was Neleus, father of the famous Nestor in the Trojan War, and the son of Princess Tyro of Thessaly. This is where things start to get very interesting. You see, Tyro was also the mother of Amythaion, but he and Neleus did not share the same father. While Amythaion was the son of Cretheus, Neleus was the son of Poseidon, who had tricked Tyro into sleeping with him, as the god so often did. Tyro was shocked when she found out, and left Neleus and his twin brother Peleas, also sired by Poseidon, to die as babies on a mountaintop. A maid or herdsman saved them, however, and they grew up with no memory of this. Time passed, Amythaion moved away from Iolcus to live in Pylos, Cretheus died, and his eldest son Aeson, Amythaion's brother, Melampus' uncle and the father of the legendary Jason, was meant to take the throne of Iolcus. But when the elder twins Neleus and Peleas discovered their royal lineage, they fought for the crown in typically brother-like fashion. You can refer to stories like Eteocles and Polyneikes for similarities here. Peleas won and banished Neleus to Messenia. The king of Messenia was Aphareus, who welcomed him, provided him with land to call his own, and so Neleus became king of Pylos. Meanwhile, with Peleos now tyrannical king in Iolcus, we learn that Amythaion's second brother Pheres was banished like Neleus, and Aeson, the rightful king, had been locked in the dungeons. Now, as recounted in the Argonautica, Peleas would only return the throne to Aeson if his son Jason brought him the Golden Fleece. Amythaion had returned to Iolcus to oppose Peleas, and Melampus had accompanied him. So when Jason assembled a crew of Greece's mightiest heroes, Melampus joined them, meaning he played a sizable role alongside the likes of Heracles in the restoration of his uncle's throne. When Aeson got his crown and his throne back, I think it would be fair to say that there would have been substantial bitterness and rivalry between Tyro's children sired by Cretheus and those sired by Poseidon. Back in Pylos, this rivalry manifested itself between Amythaion and Neleus. So while Melampus had a good upbringing, he was not loved by the ruling king. and I think therefore he would have inherited that bitterness from Neleus when his father Amythaion died. Now, I mentioned earlier that Melampus had a brother, Bias, and from context and the stories we can assume that the two were very close, and that Melampus loved his brother dearly. And it seems that over the years, Bias developed quite an attraction for Neleus' daughter, Pero. Incestuous lust aside, Melampus seemed very keen to help his brother out here. Now, as a woman of outstanding beauty, Pero naturally had many suitors, so Neleus needed some way of finding the most standout son-in-law. So he issued them a challenge. Anyone who could steal the cows of Phylacus, founder and king of Phylacae, and bring them back to Pylos, could marry his daughter. Melampus, being the elder, braver, and more capable brother, volunteered on behalf of Bias when no other suitor dared. This story is told in part by Melampus' descendant Theoclymenus, another prophet who told Odysseus' son Telemachus that Melampus set off on the long journey to Phylacae. But once he had left, Neleus saw an opportunity to gain the upper hand against his family, and so took much wealth from them by force. Hoi kre metapolla eiche biei. Melampus, ignorant of this injustice against his family, made it to Phylacae and was in the process of rustling the cows from Phylacus' fields when he was captured by a mob of cowherds and imprisoned. To add insult to injury, the crime, which he had perhaps committed by proxy on behalf of either Neleus or Bias, led to him being cursed by one of the Furies, and he was driven to the extremities of madness in Phylacus' dungeons. But his power prevailed, and thanks perhaps to Apollo's teaching, he was able to drive off the curse in exactly 1 year's time. Just in time, as fate would have it, to overhear two termites, or two worms, talking. They were chattering away about the ceiling that they'd been chewing through, and were excited to announce that it was just about ready to collapse. Melampus called out to the guards and asked them to move cells. At this point, they believed him just a harmless madman, and so agreed. But as soon as he was in the new cell, the old one collapsed. Phylacus was told and realised Melampus was special and had him summoned to his court. It turned out that his son Iphiclus was infertile, and Phylacus clearly wanted his line to continue. Ever the hustler, Melampus promised to do so only if he got the cows in return. Phylacus agreed, and Melampus set to work. He sacrificed two bulls to begin with, and called the local birds to him. A vulture passing by told him that years ago, Phylacus had been neutering rams and had left the bloody knife from this task next to Iphiclus. Obviously the young kid had been terrified and he ran away. Phylacus had decided to get rid of the knife by sticking it in a wild pear tree, a cerdos. Over time, the tree grew around the rusting knife, obscuring it. So Melampus told Phylacus he was off to find the knife, scrape the rust off it, and concoct a potion for the infertile Iphiclus. After 10 days of drinking this potion, Iphiclus' wife became pregnant. Marvelling at this, Phylacus let Melampus go, with the cows as a gift. And so the victorious young seer returned against all odds to Pylos with the herd of Phylacus' cattle. Neleus was shocked, but begrudgingly held his end of the bargain. He allowed Bias to marry Pero, and he returned all the family wealth too. But the imprisonment and the Fury's curse had taken their toll on Melampus, and suddenly not content to stay in Pylos anymore, he set off on his wanderings around the world. These wanderings took him through Greece, to Egypt, and even to Tyre in Phoenicia, where he was welcomed as divine royalty and already legendary seer into the court of King Agenor and Queen Telephassa. It was here that he met the mighty Cadmus, who would go on to become the very first Greek hero and monster slayer. He also learnt from the Phoenicians of Dionysus and how to worship this new young god. And according to this chronology, Melampus would also have been there when Zeus abducted Princess Europa from Tyre, and Herodotus believed that he accompanied Cadmus and Telephassa on their mission to reclaim her. So with Cadmus and the Phoenicians and a wealth of new knowledge, Melampus finally returned to Greece. Along the way, he happens to overhear some animals talk of a Phrygian king, Midas. Yes, this is the Midas whose touch turned everything to gold, but after that curse, he earned a new one. He had offended Apollo, who called Midas an ass, and gave him the ears of a donkey to prove his point. Midas covered these with a tall hat, and only one other person knew of these disgraceful ears, Midas's barber, who was told to keep the secret on pain of death. So just to get it out of his system, the barber went down to the riverbank and whispered the secret into a hole. King Midas has donkey ears. But the reeds around the hole, of course, heard this, and whispered to all the animals around the secret. Melampus heard it from the animals in turn, and quite cheekily told everyone around him. Midas was ashamed. When Melampus leaves Cadmus, he introduced the Greeks to Dionysiac worship, which, for whatever reason, he'd grown quite fond of. Perhaps a little madness from the Fury's curse still lingered, or perhaps he was just a fan of having fun. In any case, a few more years pass, and Dionysus becomes quite popular in Greece, as I'm sure you'll be aware, but a little too popular, perhaps. Soon, princesses from the royal family of Argos are touched by Dionysus and sent into madness. Their father, the king Anaxagoras, is in despair, but he hears of this legendary seer who was well acquainted with the mad hedonistic god and summons him to Argos. So Melampus gets to Argos and promised Anaxagoras he could cure the women of their madness, but he would need a third of the kingdom as a reward. This might sound a little much, especially as he was the one who allegedly brought Dionysus to Greece, but maybe he just really believed the women had a right to Dionysian madness. In any case, he asks for a great reward. King Anaxagoras declines, and so Melampus refuses to help. Naturally, the problem worsens, and the Bacchic madness spreads to women throughout Argive society. They wreak havoc, harming their children and running off into the hills of the Argolis, blockading roads and disrupting trade. Anaxagoras finds the seer again, and this time offers him what he wants. But Melampus was really getting into the whole hero culture thing, and this time demanded two-thirds of the kingdom. One for him, and one for his brother Bias. He said things will get far worse if they're not sorted now, and this time, Anaxagoras accepted. Melampus set about studying the situation. He read the auspices and listened to the creatures, and drawing on all his powers and knowledge, decided that the way forward was for Anaxagoras to sacrifice 20 red oxen to the titan Helios. This was because Helios, being the sun, had the widest ranging view of the world. On Melampus' word and Anaxagoras' sacrifice, the titan promised to tell Dionysus which other royals had failed to sacrifice to him, as long as he removed the curse from the Argive women. Another story has Melampus cure them of madness through the use of hellebore, drawing on his herbalist skills. But keeping with the more divine tale, Dionysus thanked Helios and agreed to the terms. So Melampus, now accompanied by his brother Bias and a team of Argive men, went into the hills and helped escort the now purified women back to their homes. Anaxagoras, who in some stories is called Proteus, duly pays up his end of the bargain and gives Melampus a third of Argos and Bias a third of Argos. By this time Melampus was ready to marry, and unfortunately the lovely Pero of Pylos had died recently, so the two brothers also married two of Anaxagoras' daughters. Melampus married Lysippe, and Bias married Iphianassa. They became kings of their respective thirds of Argos, and their children continued their royal line. From the time of Melampus, for many generations, Argos was ruled by three kings. These included his son Mantius, which literally meant seer, Oicles, who was part of Heracles' original invasion against Troy, Amphiarius, another legendary seer who was one of the seven against Thebes, all the way to Amphiolochos, who eventually gave his third of Argos back to the descendants of Anaxagoras. The sacred skill of divination and prophecy remained in his family until at least Theoclymenus during the adventures of Odysseus. No one knows exactly how long Melampus lived for, but given his divine favour and medical abilities, we can assume it was a very long time. We're also not sure if a Melampus really existed. Certainly some actual writings have been attributed to him, but they were probably fake. Since the evidence after his major exploits peters out after a while, I like to think he remained tutoring his descendants and later Greek heroes in Argos, like Diomedes, devoted to the study of plants, nature, divination, and philosophy. And maybe just a little Dionysian worship on the side.